Freemasonry is many centuries old. As a result, there is no absolute agreement as to how, where, or when it began. It is accepted it had its origins in the days of the great cathedral builders, those people who erected magnificent structures throughout Europe in early medieval times. In days when travel from place to place was often very hazardous, and most men never ventured more than a few miles from where they were born, the larger structures, such as cathedrals, major castles and the like, required a greater and more sophisticated workforce than could be recruited locally. So there arose the travelling craftsman, who journeyed from town to town across the land seeking work.
In the Middle Ages, a large proportion of the population was illiterate, and a man's credentials could not be established by his union card or a telephone call. It was necessary, however, to ensure that these craftsmen were suitably qualified for the work they were to be engaged upon, because that work, the building of immense and scientifically advanced structures, was at the leading edge of the technology of that day. Accordingly, they formed themselves into guilds to train apprentices in order to maintain the level of qualification of their membership and to protect their trade secrets, thus preventing outsiders from gaining unauthorized entry into the craft of masonry, to the risk of both reputation and employment. Such guilds were in fact professional societies, which acted to protect their members and in general to increase the reputation of their craft. Much of their work still survives after many centuries in the cathedrals, churches, and other ancient buildings of these islands. They were craftsmen of the greatest skill, devotion, and integrity, and we still find in them a living inspiration to bring like qualities to the creation of a fraternity of all men of goodwill.
The 16th century brought a gradual change in social circumstances, as it did in every branch of life. During the 17th century, the status and reputation of the craft guilds had increased to such a height that it became increasingly common for leading citizens of the town to accept invitations to become honorary members. Such people were not stonemasons and often had no connection whatsoever with the craft or guild. They were known as speculative masons, and as their numbers grew and as matters to do with the education and qualification of craftsmen were formalized and controlled at a national level, so the structure of the groups of craftsmen changed from persons solely concerned with the craft or guild of stonemasonry to groups composed exclusively of these free or accepted masons, who used the implements and materials of their operative predecessors to teach the great moral truths in allegorical fashion, based on the building of the temple at Jerusalem by King Solomon, as described in the Old Testament. Freemasons met together in groups called lodges, taken from the temporary lean-to structures that leant against the walls of the cathedrals and castles under construction while the buildings were being completed. At the same time, a national structure grew up for control of these lodges, which was called the Grand Lodge, usually with the additional title of Free and Accepted Masons. All regular Grand Lodges in the world are lineal descendants of what are known as the Mother Grand Lodges of England, Ireland, and Scotland, all three of which were formally established by the early 1700s.
The Grand Lodge of Ireland, established in 1725, is the supreme Masonic authority in Ireland, both north and south, being made up of the current master and wardens of every Irish lodge, as well as every registered past master in the Constitution. Its officers are elected or re-elected every year. Grand Lodge has delegated certain powers to provincial Grand Lodges for more efficient administration of the order. These provincial bodies govern the lodges in their designated geographical areas, although many important matters, such as final approval of laws or rules governing the order and relationships with other Grand Lodges, remain under the control of Grand Lodge itself. Provincial Grand Masters are appointed by the Grand Master, whose personal representatives they are in the respective provinces. From its inception over 260 years ago, the Grand Lodge of Ireland has been issuing warrants to groups of Freemasons, authorizing them to meet both at home and overseas. It is said with some pride that the sun never sets on Irish Freemasonry. As it goes down on the Brethren in Jamaica in the west, so it is rising on the Brethren in New Zealand in the east. Wherever you may travel in the free world, you will find men of all nations, colors, and creeds meeting as brethren do here at home and with the same basic principles of brotherly love, belief, and truth.
We are experiencing a new interest and growth with the young people who seem to find that Freemasonry is something worthwhile in life. We find that Freemasonry is a way of life, and the young people who become interested in Freemasonry find that the charitable endeavors that we have are worthwhile, and the things that we believe in, the principles and the way of life, the standards of life, are something to be concerned about and to be joined with.
Lodges operating under their individual constitutions form a worldwide fraternity, with Irish ones wherever dispersed over the face of the globe, from the Far East across the Indian and African continents to the West Indies, all subscribing to the principles and operating under the laws and constitutions of the Grand Lodge of Ireland, but having close fraternal relations with their sister bodies under the English and Scottish Grand Lodges, as well as with those of any other recognized Grand Lodge.
Ladies and gentlemen, Freemasonry is a brotherhood, or it is nothing. And it is the natural order of things that brothers sometimes should meet, talk, even eat and drink together.
Many Irish Masons helped to form the more than 100 regular sovereign Grand Lodges, which are now recognized across the world within their respective Masonic jurisdictions. Now, to be considered regular and be accepted by all other regular Grand Lodges, a Grand Lodge and its subordinate lodges must subscribe to the basic principles for recognition. The first condition of membership of the order is a belief in the Supreme Being. This is essential and allows no compromise. At the same time, Freemasonry, from its very beginning, never was, nor is it now, a religion, nor a substitute for religion, nor a combination of religions.
All Masons are required to profess a belief in the Supreme Being, and the volume of the sacred law is open while every lodge is at labor. Within Ireland, this is the Holy Bible. But where brethren of other religions, such as Jews, Muslims, Buddhists, Mohammedans, Hindus, Parsis, are present, then their holy books are displayed. Freemasonry regards a man's relationship with his God to be a purely personal matter, which is why no discussion of religion is allowed at a Masonic meeting, nor may any political matter be discussed. Daniel O'Connell himself, a member and a past master, described the craft in 1814 as philanthropy, unconfined by sect, nation, color, or religion.
The influence of Freemasonry in the leadership of our country has continued even to the present time. Approximately half of all of our presidents, up to and including Gerald Ford, have been members of the Masonic fraternity.
Brethren meet together as equals to conduct the business of the lodge, which consists of introducing new members, considering applications for the relief of those of their brethren or their dependents who may be in some form of distress, and, through the symbolism of the ceremonies, learning to lead fuller and more useful lives within the community at large. The basic Masonic unit of the lodge retains in its ritual and practices many usages from the ancient past, and these, the ceremonial secrets, have come down to the brethren from their forebears, serving as an encouragement to all Masons to endeavor in their daily lives to follow the two great commandments, to love God and love their neighbor. The brethren, though equal, submit to decisions of the worshipful master, who is elected annually to rule the lodge along with the wardens and other officers, each with his executive or ceremonial function, such as the steward of charities, who collects funds, and the almoner, who identifies those in need or distress, and the director of ceremonies and the deacons, who regulate the ceremonial aspects of lodge meetings. After the formality of the meeting, the brethren meet informally over a meal to enjoy the association and comradeship which is found in all lodges and is based on mutual trust, respect, and friendship. A formal dinner is held annually to honor the incoming master and officers for the following year. Lodges meet in rural areas in their own Masonic hall, but nowadays in urban areas, the trend is towards centralized accommodation in purpose-built premises where social activities, such as dinner dances and the like, to include families and non-Masonic friends, can be more easily catered for and enjoyed.
Here in Molesworth Street, Dublin, is the administrative headquarters of Irish Freemasonry, which accommodates the meetings of all lodges within the metropolitan area. Within the building, there is the Grand Lodge Room, and also the rooms which cater for all other branches of the order, such as the Grand Chapter Room, the Grand Council of Knight Masons Room, the Knight Templars Chapel, and the Prince Masons Room, which also holds meetings of the higher degrees. Access to these meeting rooms and to the library can be arranged, and in the museum there is a continuous public exhibition celebrating over 300 years of Freemasonry in Dublin.
The main objects of the order may be defined as benevolence and brotherly love, and these objects are realized in what are called the charities: the Victoria Jubilee Masonic Annuity Fund, the Masonic Girls Benefit Fund, and the Masonic Boys Benefit Fund. The girls and boys schools were established to educate orphan children of Freemasons, and continue to do so until recent years, when changing social conditions removed the need for such private educational institutions.
The properties were sold and trust funds established with the proceeds, enabling the order to educate the children in schools of their own choice. And as a result, the number of boys and girls being helped with their educational expenses by these two funds now far exceeds the total numbers that were educated in the two Masonic schools.
At present, there are over 570 children being assisted both in the Republic of Ireland and Northern Ireland. In 1988, the total outlay by these Masonic charities, along with the Victoria Jubilee Masonic Annuity Fund, which supports some 500 annuitants, amounted to some £750,000. Many other regional Masonic charities, such as the Belfast, the Down and the Derry Masonic Widows Fund, the Belfast Masonic Charity Fund, the Charity Fund of Grand Lodge, and others, each year help brethren, their widows, and families who are in distress. The total sum distributed by the Masonic charities in any year amounts to a sum in the region of £1 million.
The Masonic Order on its own, and in association with local authorities where appropriate, provides housing for elderly, homeless, or inadequately housed retired Masons and their wives or widows, with special emphasis on amenities to meet the requirements and disabilities of this group of dependents. There are a number of Masonic housing associations and sheltered accommodation homes, showing again how the Order's twin aims of benevolence and brotherly love demonstrate themselves in practical schemes for the benefit of others, in this case, for the elderly and those in social or financial need.
Brethren have always been encouraged to use their talents, time and money for the relief of poverty or distress. In the past, this has been exclusively directed towards Freemasonry, but in more recent times, contributions have been made to non-Masonic charities, usually from specific appeals for that purpose.
The most recent and innovative Masonic charity initiative is the decision by Grand Lodge to hold Grand Masters charity festivals at regular intervals. Festivals run for a period of a year or thereabouts, during which time individual brethren, lodges, or provinces organize fundraising events such as bring and buy sales, barbecues, sponsored runs, clay pigeon shoots, golf outings, cricket matches, and so on, which in themselves are enjoyable social occasions.
Summer wind came blowing in from across the sea. It lingered there to touch your hair and walk with me. All summer long we sang a song and then we strolled that golden sand. Two sweethearts and the summer wind. Like painted kites, those days and nights, they went flying by. The world was new beneath the blue umbrella sky.
The object of the inaugural charity festival in 1989-90 was to raise sufficient funds to establish the Freemasons of Ireland Medical Research Fund, which will directly benefit Masons and non-Masons alike. The first research projects to be so funded are into the causes of arthritis. Grand Masters festivals are supplementary to the ongoing annual fundraising needs of the Masonic charities. A further innovation has been the decision to establish a Grand Masters Appeals and Disasters Fund. This fund will make it possible to respond immediately to special appeals and our disaster funds without having to wait for the next meeting of Grand Lodge or for a special collection to be made before the help so urgently needed can be provided. Freemasonry is not for all men, many of whom in today's secular and materialistic world are busy frantically chasing the ephemeral trappings of success in a society fashioned by pressures which encourage the selfish and egotistical side of man's nature. Freemasons who enjoy a lifelong membership of the craft require a quality and maturity to appreciate the philosophical attractions which are inherent in the order, which is sometimes referred to as a progressive science. It reveals the truisms, enabling one to make a fuller and more participative contribution in life. An individual advances through the different branches, each opening another window through which to see oneself and another yardstick to gauge how one measures up. It is a constant reminder that one only gets out of life what one is prepared to put into it, and that all our actions impinge on others who may be hurt or deprived by our own thoughtlessness, carelessness, or selfishness. Such an organization will always be needed and of benefit to each succeeding generation, providing, as it still does, a center for those who would otherwise remain at a perpetual distance.